During my time as a PhD student, I was again and again confronted with the same question. Is this really true? And it turns out, sometimes there is not a trivial answer to this question. Sometimes the truth that we have accepted is disconnected from reality. Let's start with an easy example. Here we have a world map from the late 15th century. I mean, you all see that not everything is correct with this world map. But what we need to acknowledge is that at the time, the author of this map did in no way lie about the shape of his world. This was the scientific truth at his time. It was based on scientific research, on the reports from sailors, explorers, soldiers that had traveled the world. And we can appreciate some things are quite accurate. Europe, the Mediterranean Sea, North and West Africa is quite detailed. Then as soon as we go a bit away from Europe, things become fishy. Africa is there, it's a continent, but, well, okay, let's not be too picky. Asia is also sort of all right. As soon as we go to Southeast Asia, it becomes a mess. What's very interesting is that there are also a lot of tiny details, like all these little islands around the surprisingly large Sri Lanka, that we today know don't exist. And on top of all that, we're missing half the picture. There's no America, there's no Australia, no Antarctica. But today we know better. We have explored the world. We know that Earth is a sphere. We have even installed satellites to map our geography down to centimeter precision. So we have finally imagined the world correctly. We found truth. But is that so? I would argue there are still some problems. For example, it's quite difficult to depict a spherical surface on a flat map. So in order to have conformal maps in which we have no gaps between countries, we have to blow up everything that's close to the poles. If we look at a map where here it's illustrated the real size of countries and not in comparison to the blown up version, we see that a lot of our intuition about truth is actually wrong. Yes, Russia is big, but it's probably not as big as you might have thought. And the majority of landmass is part of South America, Africa, and Southern Asia. Seen in this context, it was entirely clear to me suddenly why most of the world's population live in these areas. How could it be any different? Now, let's move on from maps, because after all, I'm not an expert on cartography, at least not on this length scale. I'm part of the biophysics research group here at TU Wien. And our specialty are advanced microscopy techniques. We use these to study the distribution and dynamics of biomolecules in the membrane of cells. Especially, we're interested in immune cells. Essentially, we just try to make maps of the microscopic arrangements of biomolecules in order to figure out their function and ultimately their role in the immune system. But today, I don't want to talk so much about biology. Rather, I would like to share some more general experiences with you that I made. One such experience was that truth is not always connected with the reality in the lab. I didn't always learn this lesson easily. It came in a package with a lot of hours of fruitless work, with days full of frustration and self-doubt, normal PhD life. But still, I have to say, the time as a PhD student was one of the best times in my life. Now, essentially all research projects, and definitely all PhD projects, start in a similar fashion. You sit down and you do your background research. This could very well have been me 3 years ago. As you can see, this task is not always super exciting, but it is essential for you to assess the current state of knowledge so you can build up on that. I would imagine that sailors in the 15th century also had a glance at existing maps before they set sail, at least those who returned and lived. In my case, I had to learn a whole lot about light microscopy. The general concept of light microscopy is very simple. You take an object that you're interested in our case, it's usually cells on a glass slide, and then you shine light on or through it, and detect the reflections or transmissions of this light. Now this is, so far, just like you seeing me. What your eyes detect is the reflected light of my body. The actual microscope, then, is just a few cleverly arranged mirrors and lenses for magnification. Of course, this needs some know-how and practice, but if you arrange everything accordingly, then you can observe a tiny world that would otherwise be completely invisible to us. In this case, it's just a little single-celled organism. And you can appreciate, we can see a lot of details. We can see intracellular structures. We can even see some like hair structures on the edge of the cell. But what if we're not just interested in the optical properties of our sample? What if we want to learn about the chemical properties of the sample? Remember, we want to study the role and function of biomolecules. This is where fluorescence comes into play, but I'll explain that later. What I wanted to argue is that the cell membrane is full of proteins, many thousands of different types of proteins, and every type has a different task. There are some transporters that help the cell to absorb nutrients, there are receptors for the interaction with the outside world, or just adhesion proteins that help the cell to stick on the surface. And they all have different chemical properties, but their optical properties are very similar. So we cannot distinguish them with a simple light microscope. And there, we need fluorescence. The concept of fluorescence is that we label one type of protein that we want to study with a special dye. This labeling can be done either via a chemical reaction or via genetic engineering. Now, all we have to do is add a filter to our microscope that lets only the color of this dye pass, and that's basically it. Now we can, in the recorded images, we see only the type of protein that we want to study. Now, one thing that you will notice is that this image is a little blurred. Unfortunately, life is not like CSI, and we cannot zoom in indefinitely. The reason for this is that the wavelength of the used light is actually very large in comparison to the size of a single protein. That's why the light wave cannot precisely detect changes in position of the protein at the length scale of the protein. So the images result to be a bit blurred. You can imagine this a bit as if you were trying to color a very elaborate sketch with a giant brush. You're going to have a hard time. Luckily, there are a lot of smart people out there. And in 2006, some of them invented something that's called super-resolution microscopy. And this allows us to circumvent this problem. I will spare you all the details about this magic tool. In essence, we just use some of the photophysical properties of the dyes and a lot of post-processing on the computer. And with this, we can record images at a nanometer resolution. Having these images allows us to study the precise arrangement of our biomolecules, in our case, proteins. And one thing that becomes immediately clear is that the proteins seem to be much less evenly spread in the membrane. It almost seems as if they are organized in little islands of high density. And that's exactly what everybody found when studying proteins in a cell membrane. Everybody found protein islands. These findings were so universal that they were quickly accepted as the general ordering principle of the cell membrane. Now, this was the truth that I had studied and accepted when I started my PhD. This was the map that we used to set sail into further explorations. And we had plenty of questions about these fascinating protein islands. We wanted to know, how do they form? Why do they form? Do they contain only one kind of protein, or do they contain a mixture? And how do different islands of different proteins interact with each other? And what's the role in the immune system? So we designed, when I say we, it's a lot my supervisor as well, we designed some experiments, and then we, and now I mean I, spent weeks in the lab recording data. And then I analyzed this data, always secretly dreaming about the answers that I will find and how they will change the world. And we failed. So fortunately, life in the lab is not quite as dangerous as an expedition in the 15th century. So we came together, we discussed, and tried to figure out what had gone wrong. We replaced all the reagents, we made sure that our equipment is in good condition, and we, so I, did everything again. And we failed again. So we adapted our questions, We adapted our experiments, we asked new questions, and we failed again. Whatever we did, we couldn't answer any of the questions we were posting about protein islands. So what was going on there? After a long struggle of failed experiments and fruitless discussions, we somehow started to question the very base of our research. What if these protein islands don't even exist at all? Could all these renowned scientists have been wrong? But who am I to question them? So almost in an attempt to prove ourselves wrong, we started to develop a method to reliably prove the existence of protein islands. And the results were surprising. It turns out that the super-resolution microscopy itself had a problem. That some small experimental detail that's easily overlooked resulted in images that show protein islands where there are actually none. This tool, so powerful to map the tiny geography of the cell, had misled us to see Fata Morganas, illusions. Now, if we took care to avoid these illusions, we could find no more evidence for protein islands, at least for all those proteins that we studied. Now, of course, you have to be aware that it's very difficult to prove the non-existence of something. But I would argue, coming back to the example from the start, that if I'm sailing around Sri Lanka and I don't find islands, that maybe I should start to be willing to accept that they maybe don't exist. Still, I had troubles with that. You know, I was and I am just a student after all. So how do I dare to contradict all these real scientists out there? And I always had this inner voice inside of me that likes to quote Game of Thrones, "You know nothing, Andreas Arnold." To be honest, the voice is not entirely wrong. On top of all that, I felt like we hadn't succeeded in anything. In the end, we hadn't answered any of the questions that we had posted in the beginning. To my luck, I was in good hands. My supervisor Gerhard and my colleague Florian had a lot more experience than me in the science business, and they had already learned how to shut up this inner voice. They had understood that we should share this with the scientific community, that we had challenged a scientific paradigm, and that we had actually very strong data to back our claim. So we did what every good scientist should do. We described our method, summarized our results, and published a paper. And now it's out there for all the other real scientists to see and discuss. And the inner voice in my head is just waiting for somebody to say, "Hey, you were wrong," to prove us wrong, to show some detail that we overlooked. But it's been 2 years, and so far, it didn't happen. My PhD in the end took a very different course from what I originally expected. Instead of answering the questions of how these islands exist and why they exist, I spent all my time developing methods to prove that they don't exist at all. Well, this was sometimes a bit frustrating, I have to admit. But I learned a valuable lesson. I learned that the beauty of science is not just the discovery of new phenomena, but rather the willingness to embrace and challenge our own ignorance, to accept that we will never have the full picture. There is no shame in having been wrong all along. And sometimes it's a good idea to look back and question the path you took. Thank you.